panel on Yoko Kano's music 3 years ago. Was anybody there for that one? Oh, you were. Okay, you're getting all new material. So our policy is, even though we present at lots of conventions here in California, we've done a few in Vegas and whatnot, we never repeat the same material at the same convention. So thank you so much for joining us. Let me just we'll introduce ourselves real quick. My name is John Marr, professor of music at Santa Ana College.
My name is David Lopez, professor of music at Fullerton College.
I'm Elliot Jones, professor of music at Santa Ana College.
Okay, so for those of you here 3 years ago, we are going to do a little bit of her bio again, so just sit tight, but I want to talk a little bit about Yoko Kano, and then we're going to go ahead and go through her music one by one. We'll each be tackling one piece. If you have an empty seat next to you, raise your hand. There's one here. There are a few over there. Okay, thank you. All right, so Yoko Kano. So real quick, some real quick bio stuff here. So she was born in the Sendai in the Miyagi Prefecture up here in Japan there. She was a child prodigy. As you know, if you've ever seen her play piano live, she's excellent, and she entered many song contests and won her first prize at age 10. And she got to be quite good at that, she said. And it's interesting, if you want to know where we got most of this bio stuff, Kano does not have a Facebook page, she does not have Twitter, any of the normal social media outlets, so this is going to sound very strange, but there's an excellent interview with her on Red Bull Academy. It's from about 3 years ago, but it's actually the best interview she's ever done in English. Just I've learned more from that than almost anything, but you can pick up a lot of this info there. She did study at the Conservatoire National Supérieur de Musique, de Danse de Paris, so she did study in France, and that explains some of her facility in doing what she does. She returned to Japan and studied literature, and I've also heard writing, that she studied writing as well. Somebody told me that during the last panel here at AX. I haven't found that anywhere. Most places I've looked have said that she studied literature. The point is, she wasn't a music major, not that we mind that. Dr. Jones and I put on an anime spectacular last fall, and it was all anime music. We don't mind doing anime or video game or film, TV music as much as a repertoire. We love everything. So she did. Most rock musicians, except degrees in music. So. All right, while she was at university, she earned a reputation for being an excellent transcriber and a very, very fast worker, so she started getting some of that work pretty early on. Her first big break was being asked to write the music for a video game called Nobunaga's Ambition. I don't know if you kids have heard of that, but if you talk to your mommies and daddies a long time ago, there was something called a Sega Genesis. Okay. And as you all know, she's mostly known for anime soundtracks, although I checked her Wikipedia page and whatnot. She's been doing mostly live film for the past 4 years. I hope she comes back to anime, because quite frankly, the anime she works on, I don't know the live film she's done, but the anime she's done is really good. So, they're better than the live films, I think. All right. She often conducts orchestras, and by the way, she has conducted some pretty big orchestras, namely the Israel Philharmonic. They recorded the Macross soundtrack for her. That's not some, let's pull this group together. This is a real orchestra. That's a world-class ensemble, and she did conduct it, and they thought she did very well, which I think is fascinating. She also has a jazz big band ensemble called Seatbelts, and I would love to see them live. I've never seen her live. She gives entire concerts as a piano soloist. In fact, she gave a surprise concert here at AX back in 2010. Did anybody see that? Yeah, she just showed up. But that's her. If you know Yoko Kano, that's just who she is. I mean, she likes being kind of the one you can't find and kind of the different strange girl. But she has performed here twice. Records music in different countries to bring a different perspective and authenticity to her music. So, for instance, most of you got it earlier, you heard some of the music from Cowboy Bebop. Before she wrote that soundtrack, she took a bus tour across the U.S. to go to Chicago and listen to, Chicago blues, and head down to Mississippi to hear the Delta blues, and go to New Orleans to hear Dixieland and whatnot. So she really takes it very seriously as far as absorbing the music that she writes. However, she does avoid cliche. The music she writes is excellent, and it's whatever field, whatever genre it is, it's really, really good. She is recorded in, name this city if you can. What city?
Rio.
Very good. Let's see. How about it?
New York.
Very good.
Rome.
Ah, trick question. That's Little Italy in New York. No, I'm just kidding. All right. Anybody?
Tokyo.
Ah, yeah, that's my crowd. Nobody said Paris. Good job. This kid, this crowd knows that's Tokyo Tower. And this next one's tricky. Take a guess. Iceland. Very good. For Terror in Residence, if you've seen that movie. Okay. All right. Okay, her musical style. Basically, her Seatbelts is her group. It's a traditional big band instrumentation. Incredibly diverse, excellent musicians. Their repertoire includes, and this is what I find amazing, blues, jazz, swing, as well as bebop, rock, heavy metal, progressive rock, country. Although country's probably the country stuff she's done, maybe not the best. I've played in country rock bands, and that I found a little bit lacking. But rhythm and blues, excellent. Funk and soul, electronica, hip-hop, world music, West Africa, North Africa, India, Brazil. And I teach world music, and I can tell this is what she's pulling, this is what she's doing. Especially like Wolf's Rain, you can tell very, very Brazilian, that soundtrack, if you're familiar with it. Experimental stuff, because she likes to, as you probably know, she's always pushing the boundaries. And despite their eclecticism, her music is always excellent. Whatever genre it is excellent music of that genre. She's also influenced by many art composers or 21st century composers, especially Prokofiev, Arvo Pärt, and Steve Reich. All right, and the vocalist, I just want to list some of the people she typically works with. This is Tim Jensen, a lyricist, and he's also the one that, in the beginning of Cowboy, you know, 3, 2, 1, let's jam. That's his voice. You know, so she often writes lyrics for her. This next one, the Russian singer Olga Konstantinova passed on about 3 years ago. In fact, right after Dr. Lopez and I gave a panel at ALA, Anime Los Angeles, a week later we presented in Otakon, Vegas, and she died in the interim. This is quite sad. She did the themes to Ghost in the Shell Standalone Complex and some other stuff with Kano. Steve Conti, an American. Let's see. She goes by Ila, but Ilaria Graziano, an Italian singer. Scott Matthews from Down Under, he's Australian, Day and Night, and Gabriella Robin. Now, back in the 90s, before the internet really became a thing, and it took like 5 minutes to load a web page, and people just didn't bother, she goes by Gabriella, you'll see the name, like, lyricist Gabriella Robin, or singer Gabriella Robin. Finally, Gabriella Robin made an appearance in concert, and everybody said, hey, that's Kano, and it sounds just like this singer. So actually, she finally posted a picture of herself, Gabriella Robin, it's Yoko Kano in a bear suit. So I thought that was really cool. All right, so here is, that was the Seatbelts with Mahayane. All right, anime she's worked on, and I should mention what I didn't put in here, but this is one of the, would be Porco Rosso, the Miyazaki Studio Ghibli film. She arranged some of the music. She also arranged the music for the first chapter of Memories, Magnetic Rose, which was written by the brilliant Satoshi Kon. If you guys know Paprika or Paranoia Agent, it was him. And all the stuff they worked in with the Puccini music and Madame Butterfly and whatnot, that's her arranging. Also, she worked with Macross, of course, Bebop, Rasputin, Cardcaptor Sakura, one of my favorites ever, Ghost in the Shell Standalone Complex, Aquarium, Space Dandy, yes, she did the music for Space Dandy, which I think has one of my favorite soundtrack titles ever. Has anybody seen the second soundtrack for it? It's called Boobies Wonderland. If you guys know Boogie Wonderland by Earth, Wind, and Fire, the little disco tune, yeah, that was a great tribute and homage. And Terra Resonance, and then her last one, and I think this is the last one she's done, is Kids on the Slope, which is excellent. All right. So I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to Dr. Lopez here, and he's going to talk about Rhino Technology from Ghost in the Shell Complex. Great second step.
So one of the things that we talk about when we're talking about Yoko Kano's music is how cool it is because she pulls her inspiration from all these different sources, and so we when you listen to it, you can't help but notice those fingerprints. And in my personal opinion, I think it probably comes from her transcription. John mentioned earlier that, that one of the things she did earlier in her career was a lot of transcription. And that's when you learn a song by listening to it and then figuring out what the notes are. Has anyone in the audience ever had a song they really liked and tried to figure out the notes on a piano or another instrument? Yeah, so that's what you do when you're transcribing a tune. And in doing so, you learn a lot about it really quickly. And so I think what she does very well is she takes some elements that maybe she found in music that she liked elsewhere and decided that she wants to use those techniques in her own compositions. And this next piece, I liked it very much. I thought it was very funky. Funk music is something that we expect to hear an emphasis on the first beat of every four, okay, in the measure, and then all of a sudden you hear a guitar that does something like do it, da, 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 do it, da, da, real syncopated. But that's a very characteristic field that a lot of jazz musicians over the course of time would like to experiment with and use. Other things that we get from jazz in this tune are something that is called fusion. That's music, jazz music that's mixed with rock, with a rock feel, a rock rhythm. Jazz musicians in the 70s started to experiment with that a lot after Miles Davis realized that rock was becoming very popular and that jazz could be mixed with rock rhythms. Okay? And another thing that they did, as they wanted to kind of heighten the power of the soloist and show off the abilities of the soloist, is they went modal in some cases, okay? Meaning that they would use modes for like long periods of time, like 8 bars or 16 bars, instead of chords that change rapidly, you know, 2 times a measure and so forth. And they felt that what that did was it kind of allowed the soloist to kind of be a little more free in the notes that they choose. When chords change rapidly, if you're the soloist, if you're an improviser, you have to make decisions based on those chords, whether you use them or not, no matter what, the chords that are changing still are influencing you. So when stuff goes to a more, how you say, a simple kind of approach, a soloist has more time to make those decisions and whether or not they want to go inside or outside. Sure, go ahead.
I'm just going to demonstrate a mode. So the thing is, most music, can you hear that? Mm-hmm. Okay, so here's a scale, like a major scale. Okay, a mode is not major, it's not minor, but like, for instance, we would call this the Dorian mode.
Sorry, David. No, thank you very much. And when I listen to this piece, I don't know how many people out there are familiar with the Brecker Brothers. Anybody familiar with the Brecker Brothers band? Okay, so I hear a lot of that influence. You got that kind of 70s jazz mixed with this rock style. And even the melody, right, is kind of out of that Brecker Brothers style. Instead of like a real simple melody that goes, do a deer, a female deer, you've got angular lines which are like, right? And so that's the kind of stuff that we get here. And of course, outside playing. I don't want to get too technical, but anybody who's taken music theory knows that you know, there's certain kind of harmonies that fit at certain places. In jazz, some solos do the opposite of that. They go against it, which makes this the sound have a specific kind of rub, and that's by using substitutions. That, I mean, in other words, using other chords on top of the one that's given to you, usually a tritone away, which gives it the most bite. Okay, so we can probably take a listen a little of this if you want to.
Cool.
Hear some of that stuff right on technology.
So we're going to turn it over to Dr. Jones now. He's going to take a look at a piece from Cowboy Bebop.
Right, so we're going to listen to the Singing Sea. The Singing Sea actually has a very brief appearance in Cowboy Bebop, and its appearance in the series, in the scene, in just a moment you'll see a picture, is actually in a different form. In that instance, it's more just piano solo. We're going to play you an arrangement for vocalist and sax quartet, which is just, I think, an amazing arrangement and performance. And it's this particular post-production arrangement recording that I'm talking about here when I describe this as a twisted big band style ballad with sax choir. The term I'm using, twisted in quotes, what I'm referring to there is an emphasis on the part of the arranger to really bring out a dissonant quality. Rather than having sonorities, harmonies that are gentle on the ear, comfortable to listen to, there is an emphasis on the intervals that strike our ear with a little more of an edge, that seem to clash a little more. And in addition, that dissonant quality heightens the ironic, the nonsensical aspect of the text, which you'll see here on the next slide in just a sec. The lyrics were written by Chris Musdell, and the vocals in this particular recording are sung by Tuludana Cumberbatch. No relation to Doctor Strange and Sherlock Holmes, but as cool as his voice is, her voice is cooler. Yeah, as you'll hear in just a second. Now, simple structure. Structure in the form of any piece, whether it's a short, simple song, whether it's the third movement of a symphony, there is some kind of pattern or intentional avoidance of pattern is what we're talking about when we say structure. When we talk about structure in music, we often use labels. We use letters as labels. So if you had, for example, two sections in a piece of music, and they were a repeat of each other, so you played a melodic idea, and then you repeated that melodic idea, we would label that as AA. If, on the other hand, you played a two-section piece of music, and that second melody was contrasting, it had something that was noticeably different about it, we would label that as AB. Obviously, a two-part structure is pretty simple to start with, and an AA pattern is probably the simplest form of that binary structure, and that's what we have here. So you have a melody that is essentially the same tune repeated. So we're going for simple melody with a little more complex dissonant harmony, accentuating the kind of dark, off-kilter quality of the text. Now, one last note I want to make. The sax choir is just a brilliant choice for this. A sort of jazz ballad of this style would normally be accompanied either by a piano, maybe piano alone, maybe jazz combo, piano, drums, and a horn, like sax, for example. But to take a four-part sax choir, essentially, is a little bit of a different direction to go in. But the kind of nasal tonality, the sort of, the music is written for these saxophones in a register, in a part of their range, that emphasizes this kind of darker quality. So give this a listen. And we'll put the lyrics here up on the screen for you so you can get a sense of just how off-kilter the words are. In the show, you wouldn't have heard this text. It was there underneath that music.
The singing sea, the talking tree. Silent in a noisy way.
hope you enjoyed that. Again, a piece that you would have heard just a little bit of in the actual episode, Ganymede Elegy, and in a different form. I wanted to give you a full picture of it today.
Okay, and by the way, Dr. Jones actually performed that a few years ago after I introduced him to the music of Yoko Kano.
Really fell in love.
And you didn't bother telling me until like right before you're about to sing, I couldn't make the, but that's okay. Not that I remember things like that. Okay, well, I'm actually going to go ahead and order it a bit because we've had a couple of quiet tunes. Let's do one a little higher energy. We're going to take a listen to Lion from Macross. And this is an interesting one. Now, as I mentioned, Dr. Jones and I, it was actually his idea. We did it. We put on an anime spectacular last fall, and we kind of bled it over into the spring as well for our spring concerts. And the idea was we wanted to do some anime music, and typically with a choir, if you conduct, you have a piano, and you only have a piano. And we thought, you know, in order to make this music really come across, we need to have a full band. So we actually did have a full rock band. We had, you know, two keyboardists, we had the drummer, we had a bassist, we had a guitarist. And we had found some music.
A couple of our singers are here in the third row.
That's right. That's right. A bunch of our singers are here. I know. Thank you for coming. And the we'd found some music. I don't know if it was by Yoko Kano, but we found a book of like music arranged for choir, and we were going through the pieces, and I'm like, wait, and I found Kano's name, and I'm like, wait, and I was like pitching this to him over at Genki Sushi, I'm like, dude, let's do this one, he's like, okay, we'll do it, and I'm like, yes, so we're going to take a listen to Lion, and this is a lot of fun, so this is about Macross F, the opening theme, it's the second opening theme. Now, the duet by the, this is sung by the characters, and I have not seen this anime, I'm terribly sorry, we fell in love with the music, but we don't have time to walk down. Would like to. So this is the characters are Megumi Nakajima is the singer. Ranka Lee is the character that's here on the left, and Mayan, who is, I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right, plays a character Cheryl Nome, who is on the right there. And here they are in real life. That's what they really look like there. And here they are, their idol forms. So it's a pop tune, and it is a pop tune. But it is a crazy pop tune, and it really underlies Kano's, you know, jazz underpinnings, because it may be a pop tune, and not that she doesn't do, like, you know, two or three chord songs, but this is just so all over the map. Multiple key changes, and I'll tell you right now, for the band, this was the most fun for us to play. It was by far the most difficult, and I don't think we ever got it right, because I was playing the string parts on the key, on the synthesizers, and even those were difficult. I mean, the pianist, I mean, all of us had, it was all over the map. Now, it's a pretty straight-ahead pop tune in regards to, like, its structure and whatnot, but even though it's a little tough to hear, I want you to listen for the key changes, and I'll point them out, though. So the piece starts in A minor, but really it's kind of this A Dorian mode. So the modal elements that Dr. Lopez mentioned earlier may play not even, or they come to play not just in her jazz stuff, but in her straight-ahead pop music as well. And that's what made this piece so much fun to play, but also very, very difficult. And it was really cool because this last semester we performed this at the Rose Center Theater in Westminster. And I don't know what we call that, but we have these two huge platforms on both sides of the stage, and we put our singers right up there with the spotlights on. It looked really cool. Once we got to the platform, and once we saw this the theater, I looked at Ellie and I'm like, dude, Lion. He's like, oh yeah, that's where we're putting our soloists. So it was a lot of fun. So here we go. This is Lion. So they're up there on the slides. I'll point them out there. So lots of key changes. As far as meter, the whole thing stays in four, but like I mentioned, tons and tons of fun. Here we go.
Thank you.
was so much fun with a rock band and a full choir right behind you. Okay, so that was a lot of fun. All right, so that is Lion. Okay, so we're gonna head over to Dr. Lopez, and you're gonna take a look at another piece from Ghost in the Shell Standalone Complex.
So when listening to music, one of my favorite things to do is not only listen to the melody, but usually later on kind of listening for other things that occur inside the music as well, and listening for each role of the other instrumentalist in the group. And this is something that I think that I learned in college. I think at that point I was listening to music, and of course, like everybody else, I was, you know, falling in love with the melody and so forth, and the words of the song and all that kind of thing. But as someone showed me, you know, don't forget about what the rest of the band is. Listen to everything else. Listen to the rest of the texture. I realized it very quickly that all my music was new again, and I got to listen to and hear other things that I'd never heard before. And I advise you to do that on this next one too. This is another fusion example, another example that is going to pull from these influences of what was going on. And as jazz is mixing with rock. So what do we expect to happen when we have that type of music? You have usually a hard backbeat, usually chords that kind of aren't really all over the place and really difficult. Usually the chord movement is simplified. And the point is to get exciting music, okay, that builds energy while allowing the soloist, right, to show off the skills of the soloist to help the music develop with their improvisation. Go ahead and take a listen to a little of this. I think you're going to hear some of that stuff.
There was just a little clip of it in the actual episode. this song is featured in its entirety at the end of the series, so I have no doubt that you, many if not all of you, are familiar with the entire piece. But I wanted to talk a little bit about some of the musical characteristics and the elements within the music that, like David was just saying, if you're willing to dig in a little deeper with your ear, you can hear some of the underlying structure, and a piece that maybe you were very familiar with can become new again. Also wanted just to do another number that we had performed in our concert, because it's just been fun to relive that. And as long as I'm talking about that concert, I don't want to take too much more time because I know we're on a tight schedule here, but I just want to mention, how many of you have played in a band or an orchestra? You play an instrument of some kind, you played in an ensemble. Excellent. How about you sung in a choir, either currently or you have sung in the past? There's a lot of musicians in the room here. How many of you are currently in an orchestra, band,
actually, how
or
many?
Oh, no.
Question. Well, no. How many of you do karaoke just with your friends, like, for fun? Yeah.
Now, let me say that last question. How many of you are currently in an ensemble? That's not bad. But if you look around the room, that's a smaller percentage than have been in. Now, I want to point something out to you. Am I right that you had to stand outside before you came into this? Is that correct?
Sorry.
So I just want to point out to you that you stood outside in 105-degree weather to listen to three guys in suits talk about music. It is, and that's cool, and we appreciate that. I mean, really.
Thank you.
Yes. But it is so much more fun to make music. So get, if you're not currently, go get into a choir. Go get into a concert band. Find your local community college, because here in Southern California, you can't throw a rock and not hit a California community college. It's really that we're well provided with institutions of higher learning where you can just go out and sing or go and play. And I guarantee you, maybe Fullerton's got a pretty big program, so maybe they're going to make you on
any program. Yeah.
Most of our programs, if you come say, hey, you know, I play con man. Years, can I be in the orchestra? The director's going to say, oh, yes, you can be in the orchestra. Come talk to me. Want to sing the Santa Ana College Choirs? Yes, you're going to sing the Santa Ana College Choirs. Go make some music. Learn about it, enjoy it, and then make it. Now, here's some cool music that we had a chance to make these last couple semesters, and that is the song Blue Power Ballad. Now, we all know power ballads, right? Especially if you grew up in the 80s. How many of you grew up in the 80s? There we go. There might be. So the power ballad was just a signature gesture of the 80s. Slow tempo and crescendo. Those are some of the main elements of a power ballad. By crescendo, we mean a gradual increase of volume over time. And we might even broaden that out to say volume and intensity. So usually a ballad, especially a power ballad, starts light, starts melancholy, and then builds to a big finish. And we hear that in this piece. But that contrast that sense of crescendo provides, the composer here has taken that and really built on it. This piece is not just hear a nice build in intensity and volume, but there is quite a contrast of tone, vocal and instrumental tone quality. We begin with a very childlike vocal tone sung by Gabriella Robin. So we've learned, yes, that is what that is. Parallel thirds, simple, lullaby kind of harmonic structure, really simple way of harmonizing that line. The tone quality is kind of clear, not a lot of richness, it's like breathy quality to it, and avoidance of vibrato. Vibrato is a vocal ornamentation where we kind of vary the pitch, just wobble the pitch up and down a little bit to provide interest. That's absent here, to again create that childlike sound. Then, later, we bring in the Janis Joplin-esque kind of rough, gritty, edgy vocals of Maya Mane for the bulk of the song. In terms of structure, structure and texture, that opening, low-intensity opening, is what we call a homophonic texture. You're going to hear a main melodic idea, and everything else is designed to support that melodic idea. You've really got one thing to listen to with accompaniment, as opposed to later in the course where you're going to hear multiple melodic lines woven into each other. We would call it a polyphonic texture. Multiple melodies. Instead of one melody on top of some chords, multiple melodic lines that fit together in a very pleasing way to the ear. Last thing I want to point out is the use of nonsense syllables in the intro and later on in the course of a refrain. These, you may think that this piece opens with Latin, that maybe that they're drawing upon a medieval influence, a Gregorian chant. But in fact, these are syllables that don't have meaning. Occasionally, there are words that that are either inserted that are a real word, such as Messiah, that we hear from time to time in this text, or they are intended, they're designed to sound like a word, to evoke a particular meaning without actually being that word. The idea here, composers will set text like this if they want to create kind of a soundscape, they're trying to go for mood without maybe the baggage of real specific meaning. So with that, let's give a listen to Blue from Cowboy
Bebop. Yeah, I had to write out all those vocables. Those nonsense syllables are, but that's what we did when I arranged this for choir last summer.
Thank you. just a dream, you know, it's never ending.
I just want to mention that when I describe Yamane's voice as Janis Joplin-esque, I certainly don't mean that as a slight. Sometimes as singers, when someone says, oh, you know, you sound a lot like X, your reaction is, we're trying to imitate somebody else. You're trying to bring your, you know, maybe take an influence and make it your own. I use that as a reference in many rock and pop and even folk styles. The idea in vocal tone, vocal quality, isn't to demonstrate polish and technique. There are certainly genres, classical music is a great example of that, where you want to hear the polish, you want to hear the elegance, you want to hear the sort of very intentional beauty of tone. But in say, rock music, what you're looking for is raw emotion, sort of really unfiltered expression. And just, I mean, for my money, a female vocalist that gives you that in spades is Janis Joplin. So when somebody else evokes that same kind of rawness, that's the first thing that comes to my mind. But in no way am I trying to say she's imitating Janis. She's bringing her own quality to it. But you'll notice that there is that sort of raw quality. Pitches are often approximated. She's not holding a single pitch for a long time. She'll kind of slide up to approach it and then slide down. As a way of expression. It's very powerful.
And I was going to say, I meant to explain one thing before I skipped to the next slide here, but when I put down cantillation, what that is, that actually comes out of the cantillation came out of the Jewish tradition where they would sing psalms to God, and that actually influenced the Christian, later Islamic traditions. A denomination of Islam called Sufism uses cantillation all the time, and what it is, it's used in the Qawwali tradition. The most famous one would have been Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan. But the point is, they use these, we call them vocables, and I should have put that in, but a vocable is just a nonsense syllable. But the reason they use them is because if you're going to express Allah or God in God's entirety, how do you do it in human language? You cannot. Therefore, you switch to vocables. You just have the syllables, you have the sound, but at no point are you restricted by human language. You see, so that's another tradition that's quite interesting. I was deciding which ones to do because we have to cut one or two of our pieces. But there's one person in the crowd that I know really likes this piece. So I figure she stood in the sun a long time, so we're going to take a look at Garden of Everything. Now, this is actually not from an anime, interestingly enough. This is what's called a B-side. So, without getting too long, kids, a long time ago, had these black discs called records. And you'd buy the album, and then they'd have something called a single. And they'd want you to buy a smaller record. And you say, well, why do I want to buy the small record? I got your big one. We're going to put a B-side on it that's not on the record. Aha! So then you love your artist, and you buy the album, and you buy the single. Why? Because the single's on the album. On the flip side is what we call a B-side. Okay, and if you go to Japan now, it is still an era of CDs. They still pay $30 for a CD. I was there 2 weeks ago, and they still have CD singles. And so this would have been a B-side CD single. I know it's very encouraging. I've shown Dr. Lopez the crowds that wait for big band concerts at Tokyo DisneySea. It's amazing, nothing like what we have here. But it really was fascinating. So this is actually a B-side of a single, which was for Tune the Rainbow from Rossifon, Pluralitas Concertino, which is actually the film version of Rossifon. I've seen Rossifon. I think it's great. It's wonderful. I saw it before I saw Evangelion. It doesn't take a lot from Evangelion. I think it holds together a little bit better. But Kano did write the opening theme for Rossifon. So vocals are Steve Conte and Maya Sakamoto. Lyrics, Chris Mosdell in English and Sakamoto did the Japanese lyrics. The verses are homophonic and the choruses are polyphonic. In other words, the chorus, there's going to be more than one melody. Now, the melody that Sakamoto sings is actually a quote of a piece by the Russian composer Alexander Borodin. And if we had more time, I would speak more about him. But let me just say, he's one of my all-time favorite composers. And he was not a composer full-time. He was actually a doctor of chemistry. He was a chemist. And he wrote like five works that are classics. And so, unlike Mozart or Beethoven or some of those others that have written dozens or hundreds of works that are classic, I mean, he's immortal, but he has a really small handful of stuff that I think is great, and this is one of them. Let me just play a little bit. He actually took, this tune.
Fest, the Dance of Maidens from Polovetsian Dances by Alexander Borodin, who, by the way, in our days of Me Too and just scumbag musicians and producers and politicians and actors coming out of the woodwork, he was a good man. Yeah, if you said, I'm going to marry Borodin, I'm like, girlfriend, he was a good guy. Yeah, he was a, I just want to give him that. Yeah, by the way, a Russian who fought for women's rights way before any, look at his dates. Yeah, interesting, huh? Okay, so there he is. All right, so, as, and Borodin's music was used in Rassafon. So the verse and early verses and choruses tend to be simple as far as the texture. Now, we won't get all the way through the tune because I do want to move on. But as we get to the later ones, become more texturally complex with more electronica, more additives and whatnot. So with that in mind, I think we are ready. So this is the Garden of Everything. So listen for the, we're going to have a homophonic chorus, polyphonic verses, and just beautiful stuff. I love this.
Hi, thank you very much for this panel. I was wondering, like, let's put in perspective, like, Yoko Kanno versus Yuki Kajiura. Like, on some side, you have, like, someone who composed really simple melodies. Like, Yuki Kajiura composed really simple melodies that are used, like, you can almost, like, only one sentence, and then it repeats again, and so on. And she makes really many seasons and something. And on the other hand, you have, like, Yoko Kanno that does really complex music that will be maybe in an anime that nobody will watch because it's Turner Gundam or a Scaphony movie. So do you think there is she deliberately decides to compose the music for works that are like just one shots or works that are also highly complex, but which is not so good to talk to a large audience, right? Because we, yeah, so I want to have your opinion about that.
And by the way, please come to our panel tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. We're doing Kajiura.
Yes, okay.
Sunday, excuse me, but Sunday, then I'm tomorrow, it's Sunday. Yeah. And Kajiura is actually performing tonight at
Yeah, I know.
No, she's actually tonight. Oh, yeah, she's tonight. Okay. Regarding comparing the two, it's a little tricky. What's interesting, and we didn't get, and unfortunately, Dr. Lopez won't be able to be there, but I did give him the soundtrack to Princess Principal, which has a lot of jazz influences, yet is still Kajiura. Kajiura, I found, she pulls a lot of elements and traditions from the Middle Ages, which I find to be very interesting. So a lot of times she'll use like power chords and whatnot that are harmonically much simpler than, say, than like the more complex jazz voicings that Kano uses. As far as why they do it, now was part of your question, like, why would they do that?
Yeah, like, do you think it's related to like being strategic, like the fact that Yuki Kajiura wants to make everyone remember their music while Yoko Kanno is really hard? Yeah.
Well, that's a good question. As far as, here's the thing. When it comes to soundtracks, because my degree's in composition, I teach theory. Oh, in fact, we looked at Lion in my Music Theory 1 class, so I'm like, okay, once you've learned about keys, now watch this. And, the point, though, with it, is that people asking, do you notice soundtracks? For the most part, I don't notice soundtracks. I mean, like, what do you think of the music for, like, Avengers films? They're very generic, except for Ragnarok. Ragnarok was cool. The rest are kind of, so the only time I notice something is when it's really good or really bad. So with Kano and Kajiura, they want something memorable, but the thing is, you have to work with your director, your producer, and bring across whatever they're going for. The thing with Bebop, and if you've read the interviews with the director, her and him, they would just go back and forth. Like, she would write music, then he'd write a story about it, which is opposite of the way it's normally done. Because typically, you get here's the movie, it's locked. Because the last thing that we call it locked, because once they have the final cut, the director's done what he wants to do, editor does what he needs to do. You got your full, you got your sound effects, ADRs, and the movie's now locked. Composer, write to this. And you're stuck to whatever it is. You may have an idea, but if it's like a millimeter or a millisecond off, it's not going to work. So I actually teach a course at Santa Ana College where we put music to video. And because I'm me, we have these one-minute anime, I make them all do also. And the thing is, so typically you have to kind of put it in kind of, but you can compose, but it's a pretty tight box. Okay. As far as expressing yourself, as far as making it memorable, that's up to the composer. It depends on the composer, depends on the situation. And in cases like Blue, you're going to remember Blue, right? Mm-hmm. Some of the stuff that Dr. Lopez tackled, you probably know it, but it's not like the main thing. You know what I mean? It's the music's there, but you won't really notice it. So like with one piece that we did do today, Trip City, which I love, from Ghost in the Shell Standalone Complex. It's this crazy rock piece that changes meter a bunch of times. It's like source music during one of the Tachikoma scenes, if you guys have seen Ghost in the Shell Standalone Complex. So I was wondering where it would come in, and I'm like, oh, that's it. So it just depends, really.
Mm-hmm,
I don't think it's a very good answer, sir.
Okay, no, it's okay.
Okay, all right. Other questions? Yes? Everything, yes. Film school, if they say we're going to teach you how to write film music, avoid that. Like film music projects are typically not that good. Study composition and study as much as you can. Study, take history. You need to know everything. Because the thing is, if the producer says, you know something, I want, because so many soundtracks rip off other composers or they sound like them. If you can, if someone says, I want something that sounds like them, you need to be able to do that. Or if they say, I really want like a Stravinsky vibe, or or even like a classic rock vibe, you have to be able to do that. Kano does that better than anyone. She's excellent at that. Not that she's deriving, but she's good at speaking every language beautifully. Okay, but take as much theory as you can. Understand all sorts of music. Okay, and then after that, you got to hustle because a lot of it's just connections. Not even talent. It's not really talent, kids. It's connections. It's getting out there. No. It's like hustling your music and and not sleeping. And remember, every composer. If you see like a composer, that composer probably did not write the music. Every composer has five or six composers working for him or her, assisting to write the music or orchestrating, getting parts together.
You know, I was just going to say, this is a slightly different venue or aspect of music than what you were asking about, but the principle holds true. When I was doing undergrad and grad work at Arizona State University, I got to know a lot of people who were in the vocal performance program, who were a lot of the singers, actually married one of them. But I was always struck by the number of those vocal performance majors who would pigeonhole themselves. They would put themselves in a box. I only do this style. And if they were in choir, because maybe they got a choir scholarship, and the director needed a different style, they kind of push back against the director. That's not my style. I don't do that. My voice, that's going to hurt the vocal technique. And I always thought that was crazy, because if you're a singer, you want a gig, right? You've got to get the job. So what's going to get you more jobs? Being only a classical vocalist? Or being someone who can say, yeah, I can do country. Yeah, you want to rock singer? I can do rock. Jazz? Sure, I can do jazz. So what John was just saying, do it all, I think is really great advice for any musician. Try to internalize as much as you possibly can. Listen to as many different styles as you can. Try to write as many different styles as you can. Give yourself challenges. Give little tests. Okay, today I'm going to write a jazz song. Tomorrow I'm going to write a medieval organum, some simple polyphony. And if you do that, then when the director, you land a shot, maybe not even the gig, but you land a shot at a gig, and the director says, here's the scene we've done, and here's the piece that's in my mind, right? And they're hearing a Tchaikovsky piece, or they're hearing a piece of Gregorian chant. You then understand how to take that influence and then sort of put it forward in your own voice, because you're not new to that language.
Okay. Well, listen, thank you. We're out of time. Oh, so like her music is available on iTunes. Remember, appreciate good art with your wallet, okay? Do not steal music. Thank you. If you have any questions, I'll look this up. You may take a photo. If you want to get further questions,